First of all, I would like to thank you, the organizer, for getting this meeting and for putting us all together, because I believe that we're coming from different backgrounds, and hopefully after this meeting we can find some interesting idea and also some fruitful collaboration after all. So this morning I would like to present you one of my research topics about the use of metamaterial for. And secondly, I will show you how to engineer the metal material so that it can provide us the effective platform for tracking and for identification of the change in conformation of the geoplex structure. And secondly, I will provide several examples for the use of the material for center detection and identification of the nuclear brain cancer biomarker. And finally, it will come up with some conclusion. The analysis of the molecular interaction and also the conformational dynamic of biomolecules is critically important to understand their vital function in the complex biological system, and as well as to help us to develop some nano platform for disease diagnostic and also for the drugs recovery. So for to meet the purpose, we have two main approaches. The first approach using molecular fingerprinting analysis. In this approach, we have several techniques involving the X-ray crystallography, FTIR, Raman spectroscopy, or NMR. Those kind of techniques provide you the direct information of the chemical bond or the chemical vibration mode or the chemical signature of the target biomolecule or the chemical of interest. However, it's not suitable for real-time analysis, and it's also not suitable to provide you by kinetics and biophysically. And for the second approach, mostly about the quantitative analysis, we can have several sensing platforms based on fluorescent light scattering, based on tracking and refractive index, electrochemistry, surface plasmon resonance, or localized surface plasmon resonance. Those kind of sensing approaches is ideal for tracking the refractive index, and it's also a very good platform for providing real-time analysis and kinetic binding. However, it's not so very helpful for identification of unknown molecule. Most of the time, when we want to identify any target molecule, we need the ligand, we need the complementary capturing molecule, so that this can help us to identify the target of interest. And also, it's not so suitable for providing the confirmation and fingerprinting information of the biomolecule. And this also has a very high phosphate rate. So therefore, there's a very great demand for the multiple devices that can help us tracking both qualitative and quantitative analysis of the molecular binding event. So in the presentation, I will present to you the use of metamaterial that can help us interact with your functionality. One using the molecular fingerprinting analysis, and the other one is going to be used for quantitative analysis based on the reactive index sensing. So first upon about the interaction of the metamaterials. So by definition, the metamaterials are large-scale densely of periodic artificial atoms with their optical properties can go beyond the limitation of conventional nature occurring materials or composite. So for the natural materials, we know that the properties of the material, for example, the chemicals or the physical properties of materials will be defined by the arrangement of the atoms within the molecule. And based on the arrangement, for example, the carbon atoms can help us to identify whether materials is graphene or carbon number 2 or fullerene. However, for the metamaterial, it atom here in this figure, this demonstrates the split ring resonator. This has the same function as the natural atoms. And by arranging different artificial atoms, this can build up the new type of material Their properties can go beyond what happened in the nature. So for the metamaterial, it's a very young, very new research area. However, in this area is very dynamic. If we look at some database, for example, if you look at the database from Scopus previously, that the metamaterial it just emerged in, let's say, 15 years ago. And this was first proposed by Vesalago in 1968. He proposed that it's very possible to make a material with a negative refractive index. However, at that time, there's no instrumentation, no equipment, there's no facility to realize the materials. And until 1998, Sir John Benary from Imperial College London, he proposed theoretically the use of splintering resonator to realize the negative refractive index materials. And until 2002, Smith and Shelby were first experimentally realized the negative refractive index using the splintering resonator in the gigahertz region. And since then, the realization of metamaterial for operating in gigahertz, and also people want to push the optical response up to visible region, this has blown since then. So we can see that even the number of applications by year is quite low, but the citation or the impact in this area is enormous. And for the application of the metamaterial right now, the material can be used for negative refractive index, it can be used for transformational or switching optics, and also this can be used for biosensing. I have the background biology and also biochemistry, so I just focus on the use of the metamaterials for biosensing purposes. For the metamaterial, because it's the artificial material, so that we can design, we can fabricate it at this size and also at different morphology, so that this can provide us the optical properties as well as what we want. With the metamaterial, actually, we can put the optical region from microwave to optical response just by changing the size and the shape of the material. Here, I just put several fabrication techniques and with different timeline. For example, for the microwave split ring resonator, we can use the printed cardboard lithography to fabricate the device. And also, we can use some micro lithography or electron beam lithography or focused ion beam lithography to fabricate the material with a smaller size. And when we're doing the size of the split ring resonator, so the split ring resonator is equivalent to the LC circuit. So their optical response will be followed by this equation where L is the inductance and the capacitance of the LC circuit. So as we can see, when we reduce L and C, we can increase the optical frequency of the materials. So just by changing the size of material, we can do the optical response of the material so that we can use the material for the biosensing purposes. For fabrication of the metamaterial, one of the most powerful techniques is using the electron beam lithography. Using electron beam lithography involves first the deposition of the electrophoresis onto the wafer or the substrate that you want. This can be glass, this can be different type of polymer. And then we will expose electrophoresis to the electron beam, and after several development and the metallic deposition, we will have the nanostructure is what we design. So using EBL, we could fabricate the split ring resonator with a size from 25 nanometers. We believe this is the world's smallest size for the split ring resonator, and up to 80 nanometers. Of course, we can make something bigger. However, when we reduce the size of the split ring resonator, somehow we can push the optical response to the visible region. And that's what the device sensing platform should be. Because when we push to the visible region, we can enable several sensing approaches. For example, we can enable the surface thinking from monitoring spectroscopy, and also we can use it for sensitive refractive index as sensing. So what MegaMaterial can offer? First, it can offer us the tunable plasmonic resonance from UV, GUNY, IR as well. Secondly, it can provide us the dual sensing channel. The first channel is using a surface enhanced Raman scattering spectroscopy. It can provide us the fingerprinting signature, biochemical or biomolecular. And this can provide us the sensing based on the refractive index due to the biological interaction between the analyte and the capture ligand. And also, the MegaMaterial can provide a detailable intelligent coupling effect between different artificial atoms. And because we can fabricate it using the top-down lithography approach, so this has a very high reproducibility. So here I present here is just an example of how we can tune the optical response of the plasmonic MegaMaterials. We can fabricate the MegaMaterial with different size, different shape. Here we have the U shape, Y shape, H, U bar, and V shape. And also we can tune it with different size. When you tune the material with different size, you can tune the plasmonic response mode, is what we want. And also, because we know that Raman spectroscopy is a very weak spectroscopy technique, if we provide to the chemical or biomolecular, let's say million photon, there's only one photon scattered back a Raman signal. Therefore people have developed several substrates that can enhance the Raman scattering signal. And one of them is plasmonic substrate, and the MegaMaterial can serve the role of the surface-enhanced Raman scattering substrate. However, to get the highest signal out of the surge substrate, we need to optimize it. Not only the laser frequency will work for the surge substrate, we need to optimize so that the localized surface plasmonic resonance of that substrate, this must be as low as possible to the laser excitation wavelength. And for the conventional surge substrate, using the colloidal nanoparticle, this was almost impossible to do that. So for the MegaMaterial, because we can tune the size and the shape easily, so somehow we can optimize the LSPR for the plasmonic MegaMaterial to match with different laser wavelength. So in this figure, first I fabricated the split ring resonator, and then I deposited naphthalene thiol. It's a chemical and also a Raman active substrate. I deposited the naphthalene thiol onto the top of the materials, and then I excite the material with the laser with different polarization degree, parallel to the gap or vertical parallel to the gap. And then I can use different laser energy from 660 up to 840 nanometers. So in this figure, we can see that for the H shape with different parallel polarization degree, we can have different solid signal. And in this figure, we can see that for the H shape and for the polarization degree parallel to the gap, we can have the highest signal when we use the laser frequency around 1.8 electron volts, or just around 690 nanometers. And when we excite the MegaMaterial to the wide axis or just vertically to the gap, we can have the highest laser frequency around 1.5 something, or the laser frequency should be around 790. It should be around this. So therefore, it just gives us an example how can we fabricate the material, how can we do this optical response, and how can we get the high-resolution signal just by changing the size, barometricity, and also the shape of the materials. So in the next slide, I will give you one application example of the use of nanomaterial for tracking the learning grid sequence or the gene complex, and also for the bioaffinity identification. For the gene complex is a molecule which has a very important biological role. Usually the gene complex structure is the repeatable sequence and contain a lot of learning in the structure, and we usually follow the gene molecule nucleotide by the end of this telomere. So with the gene complex, instead of applying to standard based on the Boston Greek fashion, the learning can be expanded by the Hochstein Harrison bone, this one. And this has been indicated that when the learning from the gene complex or the gene complex, the gene complex can stop on each other when it is the potassium or sodium cation. The cation can stop the gene complex together, so that it can form different intramolecular structure or intermolecular structure. And the gene complex has been also proposed in new anti-cancer drugs because people believe that it can interact with the nucleolin. Nucleolin is a protein biomarker that excessively present in the cancer cells. So in this figure, for the normal cell, normally there is no surface nucleolin. Therefore, there will be no attack of the nucleolin. In the cancer cell, the cancer cell will express a very high concentration of the nucleolin, and the gene complex can bind to the nucleolin, and then this will interfere the biological activity of nucleolin. And as a consequence, the gene complex, this will degrade proliferation of the cancer cells, and in the end it will kill the cancer cells. So this is just an overall figure to describe the working mechanism of the interaction between nucleolin and gene complex, so that this can provide a very good direction for the development of the new drugs for cancer. So using the metal material, I can provide the unique integrated platform so that I can track the interaction between the nucleolin and gene complex, and at the same time, I can track the conformational change of the gene complex from the single-stranded oligonucleotides when it formed into the gene complex and at different environments. So this platform just can be a level free. We don't need to label the biomolecule, and this can provide us the fingerprint signature of the biological material, and also just based on the optical response, we can identify the concentration of the target molecule. In this case, this can be the gene complex, or it can be the nucleolin biomarker. So in the first experiment, we need to optimize the resonator size. So in the figure, this is a split ring resonator fabricated by electron beam lithography. The size of the width is just around 45 nanometers. This is just one representative image. We could fabricate the nanomaterial with three size from 35 nanometers to 55 nanometers. And here in the figure B, it's an experimental optical response that measured by the just a normal UV vis spectrometer. And in the figure C, it's the simulation result. As we can see, when we increase the size from 35 nanometers to 55 nanometers, we can push the electric response and as well as a magnetic response to the longer wavelength or to the lower frequency. And the practical and the experimental result match very well with the theory simulation. And in the figure A, we put the DNA, the G1-plex DNA, onto the top of the mega material, and then we just simulate the electromagnetic field enhancement using 785 nanometer laser excitation. And as we can see, the the metamaterial with the size of 45 nanometers give us the strongest electromagnetic field enhancement. And when we measure the Raman scattering spectra, we could observe that Raman signal coming from the U45 give us the highest surge signal. Therefore, we select the metamaterial with the size of 45 nanometers and with the laser wavelength of 785. It's a good platform to develop the sensing technique further. So this is the result when we put the DNA onto the top of U45 metamaterial, and we just track. First, we track the refractive index. We just measure the optical response of the U45, and we can identify the transmission bit right here. But when we put the single-stranded DNA onto the top of metamaterial, because the DNA will increase the local refractive index, so the optical response will shift to the longer wavelength. And as well as when we induce the G1-plex formation by adding the potassium cation, and this will form the G1-plex, and the refractive index also increase correspondingly. And we can track that process. However, we know that this uptake of the G1-plex by the coordination of the potassium cation is very weak bond. So just by watching at 90°C for 10 minutes, the coordination of the cation will be released, so therefore the G1-plex structure will return to its initial state. And just by using the optical response mapping, we can identify something happened onto the surface of the material. However, to critically or specifically identify what happened, we measure the fingerprinting signature of the oligonucleotide by using Raman spectroscopy here on the solid substrate. We just measure the gold film only because the gold is a very good material. Gold and silver, they are very good material for Raman spectroscopy and as well for surge. So we just measure the Raman signal on the gold film, and there is nothing because there is no molecule. And when we measure the Raman spectroscopy of the DNA in water, we could observe the fingerprint of the DNA. However, there is no hosting hydrogen bone would represent at the wave number at 1492 or 1480, just around that area. And when we induce the G1-plex formation by adding potassium cation, we could observe a very significant change in this signature band 1482. And when we wash away by the water, the hydrogen bond or the Hoogstein hydrogen bond is decreased. And when we wash at 90°C for 10 minutes, it's come back to the initial state that corresponding to the optical measurement in this area. And also, we are also tracking the G1-plex formation under different buffer conditions. For example, in lithium buffer in water, and also we hybridize it with the complementary DNA. So in this case, this will form the Western brick structure, not the Hoogstein hydrogen bond. And also, we investigate the G1-plex formation under the potassium cation induction. So we clearly see that when we add potassium cation into the oligonucleotide, the G1-plex forming with the biomarker at 1480 wave number. And then when we When we proved that using the metamaterials can be a very good platform for cracking the fingerprinting of the chemical and biological materials, and then I used the material to identify the interaction between the nuclear pine, the nuclear plane with the G complex. First, I analyzed the fingerprinting signature of the nuclear plane. In this case, I just used a very short peptide sequence of the nuclear plane protein. This is my replication of the RGG, the structure, and here's the fingerprint of the nucleotide of the nuclear plane peptide. There is no spin hydrogen bond. And after binding, and here, this is a fingerprint of the G complex that is used in potassium cation. We can observe a very clear hook spin hydrogen bond right here at 1480. And when it's bind with the G complex, we can identify the fingerprinting signature of the dual plane at about 1030 weight number, and also at the 1170. And at the same time, we could observe the hook spin hydrogen bond there. So that's me, it's confirmed that, using the metamaterials can help us tracking the biological interaction between G complex just based on the fingerprinting of the nuclear plane itself and also based on the G complex structure. And then using the optical response, we can identify different concentration of the nuclear plane that can bind to the G complex. And we can, when we fit it to the Langmuir equation, so we can identify the detection limit of the assays down to 10 to the minus 11 more. And also, the KD is quite strong, around 3 plus 10 to the power minus 10 more. And the detection limit is down to the picomolar rank. So for the conclusion, using the metamaterial, this can be used to fabricate a very good nanosensing platform. We can tune the plasmonic response of the metamaterial almost as well. So we can use it to provide the unprecedented spatial and structural resolution for resolving the characteristic vibrational signature of the molecule, and also it can help us tracking the refractive index induced by the biological interaction. And the fabric and the fabrication of the metamaterial is very compatible with some top-down approach, so that we can combine the metamaterial with the net on the chip technology, so that we can provide the fully integrated and miniaturized micro devices with a huge potential application in discovery of new drugs and this way for the disease diagnostic. So I would like to thank my collaborator in Nanyang Technological University in Singapore. So this and also Professor Bingheng Tan from Chinese Academic Science in China. And thank you very much for your attention. If you have any questions, please let me know.